Hello all, we shall be discussing today about early Christian art, 100 to 600. The objectives of this chapter are: acquire the basic vocabulary, concepts and criteria for understanding, interpreting and analyzing early Christian art, encounter significant works of the period and enable them to study later works influenced by this period. Understand and appreciate the role of values, beliefs, and ideas in shaping early Christian art. We start with introduction. Early Christian art and architecture, also known as Paleo-Christian art, is the art produced by Christians or under Christian patronage from the earliest period of Christianity to, depending on the definition used, sometime between about 350 to 525. In practice, identifiably, Christian art only survives from the 2nd century onwards, after 550 at the latest. Christian art is classified as Byzantine or some other regional type also. The teachings of Jesus and his followers led to the establishment of the Christian religion. The roots of Christianity were in Judaism, since Jesus himself was a Jew. Like Judaism, Christianity was founded on written texts, was monotheistic, and taught a code of ethics. Two important moments played a critical role in the development of early Christianity. The first was the decision of Apostle Paul to spread Christianity beyond the Jewish communities of Palestine into the Greco-Roman world, and the second was moment when the Emperor Constantine at the beginning of the 4th century accepted Christianity and became its patron. The creation and nature of Christian art were directly impacted by these moments. The beginnings of an identifiable Christian art can be traced to the end of the 2nd century and the beginning of the 3rd century. The use of images in early Christian art is a Greco-Roman influence. As Christianity gained converts, these new Christians had been brought up on the value of images in their previous cultural experience, and they wanted to continue this in their Christian experience. As the Christian converts wanted the same things, Christian catacombs were dug frequently adjacent to non-Christian ones, and sarcophagi with Christian imagery were apparently popular with the richer Christians. In this process, known as syncretism, artists assimilate images from other traditions and give them new meanings. The borrowings can be unconscious or quite deliberate. For example, Orient figures worshippers with arms outstretched in prayer can be pagan, Jewish, or Christian, depending on the context in which they occur. Catacomb paintings. Christians like Jews used catacombs for burials and funeral ceremonies, not as places of worship. During the 3rd and 4th centuries, the early figural representation of Christ show him as Good Shepherd by directly borrowing from classical prototype. He was also sometimes depicted in the guise of familiar gods and heroes, such as Apollo or Orpheus. Only later when the religion itself had achieved some measure of earthly power, did he take on more exalted attributes. Narratives tended at the first to be typological, after suggesting parallels between the Old and New Testaments. The earliest scenes from the life of Christ to be depicted were the miracles. In the Christian catacomb Commodilla, figure 2, dating from the 4th century, long rectangular niches in the walls called loculi each held two or three bodies. Affluent families created small rooms or cubicula, singular cubiculum, of the main passages to house sarcophagi. The cubicula were hewn out of tufa, soft volcanic rock, then plastered and painted with imagery related to their owner's religious beliefs. The finest early Christian catacomb painting resembled murals in houses such as those preserved at Rome and Pompeii. Look at figure 1. We have put it by courtesy Adams Laurie from his book A History of Western Art. Figure 2. Cubiculum of Leonis, Catacomb of Commodilla, Rome, late 4th century. Figure 3. The Good Shepherd, Orange, and the Story of Jonah, painted ceiling of the Catacomb of Assis, Peter and Marcellinus, Rome. Roman catacomb, 4th century Roman catacomb contained remains or relics of SS Peter and Marcellinus, 2-3rd century Christians martyr for their faith. Here, the ceiling of the cubiculum is partitioned by a central medallion or round compartment and four lunettes, semicircular framed by arches, figure 3. At the center is a good shepherd whose pose has roots in classical sculpture. In its next context, the image was a reminder of Jesus' promise. On the left, Jonah is thrown from the boat. On the right, the monster spits him up. And at the center, Jonah reclines in the shade of a vine, a symbol of paradise. Orange figures stand between the lunettes, presumably images of the faithful Christians who were buried here. Sarcophagi, a marble sarcophagus in Church of St. Maria Antiqua in Rome, exemplifies continued Roman imagery in early Christian art. Figure 4. The side in his figure has both Old and New Testament scenes, as well as figures combining Roman and Christian meaning. Reading from the left to right, the first character, Jonah, from the Old Testament emerges from the well. Jonah's form is based on the idealized classical nude, which the whale is represented as a fantastic fish. This story was well suited to a Christian sarcophagus, since Christians interpreted it as a typological prefiguration of Christ's resurrection. Just as Jonah spent 3 days inside the well, so Jesus was entombed for 3 days before his resurrection. To the right of Jonah are Christian transformations of Greco-Roman poet and his muse. The seated poet wears a Roman toga, but is shown as a Christian poring over a religious text. The muse is also in classical dress. She stands with her arms raised in a gesture that combines prayer and mourning with a visual reference to Jesus' cross. Most of the times, making them was an expensive affair, and they were made of marble and often heavily decorated with scenes in a very high relief, worked with drills, packed with elaborate figural scenes. The sarcophagus, figure 5, is divided into two registers, separated by columns. Entablatures and gables divide the space into fields for individual scenes. In the center of both registers is a triumphant Christ. Above, the Junius Bassus appears as a Roman emperor, distributing legal authority in the form of scrolls to flanking figures of asses, Peter and Paul, and resting his feet on the head of Culius, the pagan god of the heavens, he representing the cosmos of identity, Christ, as a cosmocrator, ruler of cosmos. In the bottom register, the early Jesus makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, like a Roman emperor entering a conquered city. Jesus, however, rides on a humble ass rather than a powerful steed. Even in the earliest Christian art, such as that in catacomb paintings and here on the sarcophagus of Junius Bassus, artists employed episodes from the Hebrew Bible allegorically, since Christians saw them as prefiguration of important events in the New Testament. At the top of left, Abraham passes the test of faith and need not sacrifice his son Isaac. Christians saw in this story an allegory that foreshadowed God's sacrifice of his own son, Jesus, which culminates not in Jesus' death, but his resurrection under the triangular gable. Second from the end, at the bottom right, the Hebrew Bible story of Daniel, saved by God from the lions, prefigures Christ's emergence alive from his tomb. At bottom far left, God tests the faith of Job, who provides a model for the sufferings of Christian martyrs. Next to Job, Adam and Eve have sinned to set the motion the entire Christian redemption story. Adam and Eve have sinned to set in motion the entire Christian redemption story. Lured by the serpent, they have even, next to Job, Adam and Eve have sinned to set in motion the entire Christian redemption story. Lured by the serpent, they have eaten the forbidden fruit, and conscious of their nakedness, are trying to hide their genitals with leaves. On the upper right side, spread over two compartments, Jesus appears before Pontius Pilate, who is about to wash his hands, symbolizing that he denies responsibility for Jesus' death. Jesus' position here, held captive between two soldiers, recalls and perhaps could also be read as his arrest in Gethsemane, especially since the composition of this panel is reflected in the arrest of Apostle Peter, top second frame from the left, and Paul, bottom far right, right as Marilyn and C. Michael. Figure 4, early Christian sarcophagus, S. Marilyn in Tukua, Rome, 4th century marble. Although the Christians continued to decorate their sarcophagi with relief sculptures, as the Greeks, Etruscans and Romans had done, they omitted the effigy of the deceased from the cover of the tomb. They also eliminated cremation because they believed in bodily resurrection. Figure 5, sarcophagus of Junius Bassus, grottoes of St. Peter Vatican, Rome. Let us now discuss sculpture. Figure 6, the Good Shepherd, Eastern Mediterranean, probably Anatolia, Turkey, second half of the 3rd century marble. Architecture. In the 4th century after Constantine accepted Christianity, the rapidly growing Christian population, now supported by the state, needed to build larger and grander public buildings for worship than the mostly discreet meeting places they had been using, which were typically in or among domestic buildings. Before this, pagan temples remained in use for their original purposes for some time. They were free to construct places of worship. Greek temples had served as the house and treasury of gods, forming a backdrop for ceremonies that took place at altars in the open air. In Christianity, an entire community gathered inside a building to worship. Unlike Greek and Roman temples, whose main purpose was to house the statue of a god, Christian churches were built so that crowds of believers could gather together for worship. With the active support of Constantine, many churches were constructed in a very few years. In Constantinople, in Italy, in the Holy Land, elsewhere in the Holy Empire, churches were modeled on the architectural design of Roman Basilica, which was able to hold large number of people and could be adapted for Christian worship. The early Christian Basilica was to become the basis for church architecture throughout Western Europe. From the age of Constantine, pagan basilicas provided the model for congregational churches, and tombs provided a model for baptisteries and martyr shrines. Old St. Peter's Constantine order the construction of a large new basilica to mark the place where Christians believed St. Peter was buried. None of the early Christian basilicas have survived in their original form, but an accurate floor plan of St. Peter's Basilica have been reconstructed by archaeologists. The architectural design of Christian Basilica was adapted to the requirement of Christian ritual. The altar, where the Mass was performed, was its focal point. It generally supported a crucifix with the image of Jesus on the cross turned to face of congregation. A narthex across the width of building provided a place for people who had not yet been baptized. 5 doorways, a large central portal into the nave, and 2 portals on each side gave access to the church. Columns supporting an entablature lined the nave, forming what is called a nave colonnade. Running parallel were double sides aisles. These columns supported round arches rather than an entablature. The altar and apse at the old St. Peter's were framed by use triumphal arch, a regular architectural element of early Christian basilicas. The architects thus assimilated the Roman triumphal arch and transformed its meaning to refer to the triumph of Christ rather than of the emperor. Old St. Peter's could hold at least 14,000 worshippers, and it remained the largest church in Christendom until the 11th century. Look at figure 7, Jacopo Grimaldi, interior of St. Peter's, 1619, copy of an earlier drawing. Also look at figure 8, Church of Santa Costanza, Rome, circa 350, view from the ambulatory into rotunda. Now we discuss Santa Costanza. Central plan Roman building with vertical rather than longitudinal axis was another model for Christian tombs, martyrs, churches and baptisteries. One of the earliest surviving central plan Christian buildings is the mausoleum of Constantina, daughter of Constantine, constructed as a church in 1256. According to S. Marlin and C. Michael, the building, figure 8, is a tall rotunda with an encircling barrel vaulted. One of the earliest surviving central plan Christian buildings is the mausoleum of Constantina, daughter of Constantine, constructed as a church in 1256. According to S. Marlin and S. Michael, the building, figure 8, is the tall rotunda with an encircling barrel vaulted passageway called an ambulatory, paired columns with composite capitals and richly molded entablature. Blocks support the arcade and dome. Originally, the interior was entirely sheathed in mosaics and veneer of fine marble. Mosaics still surviving in ambulatory vault recall syncretic images in the catacombs. In one section, for example, a bust portrait of Constantina at the crest of vault is surrounded by a tangle of grapevines filled with putty naked cherubs derived from pagan art who be with birds to harvest the grapes. Figure 9. Along the bottom edges on each side, other putty drive wagon loads of great stored pavilion housing large weights in which more putty trample the grapes into juice for the making of wine. The techniques, subject and style are Roman and traditionally associated with Bacchus and his cult. But the meaning here is new. In a Christian context, the wine references the Eucharist and trampling of grapes to transform them into wine becomes an image of death and resurrection. Constantina's pagan husband, however, may have appreciated the double illusion. Figure 9, harvesting of grapes, ambulatory vault, Church of Santa Constanza, Rome. Figure 10, elements of architecture. The oratory of Galla Placidia. As Rome's political importance dwindled, that of northern Italian city of Ravenna grew. One of the earliest surviving Christian structures in Ravenna is an oratory, small chapel, attached about 425 to 426 to the narthex of church of the Imperial Palace. Figure 11. It is named after Honorius, remarkable half-sister, Galla Placidia, daughter of the Western Roman Emperor, wife of a Gothic king and mother of Emperor Valentinian. This small building is cruciform or cross shape. A barrel vault covers each of its arms and a pendentive dome. A dome continuous with its pendentives covers the square space at the center. The interior of the chapel contrasts markedly with the unadorned exterior, a transition seemingly designed to stimulate the passage from the real world into the supernatural realm. When you look from the western entrance across to the eastern bay of the chapel, see brilliant mosaics in the vaults and panels of wind marble seething the walls below.